many questions, yet we say we wise. The journey continues in life, yow. I give thanks for life every day that I survive. The journey continues in life. We wonder why we have so many questions, yet we say we wise. The journey continues in life, yow.
Good afternoon and welcome to The Journey to the Cross and Beyond. I am your host, Kay Brown. Been away for a little while, but I'm so glad to be back. Of course, you know how I love to start out this show, always giving honor and glory to God, who is the reason why we live, breathe, sleep, and do everything that we do. I just want to give a shout out to Trey, who's our engineer today. This is like the first time that it's just me and him working together. So we're going to see how that goes, and I'm expecting it to go really, 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 really well. How's everybody out there doing? I hope you all are doing well. Throughout the show, if your heart is stirred, you can feel free to call us up at 718-239-9200. One of the things I want to do today, being that it's just you and I that are talking right now, we may get a guest sometime during the show, but we'll see what happens. Traveling mercies to them if they are on their way, but I'm kind of glad because I really will get this opportunity to talk to you. So Trey told me that, one second, rewind a little bit. He said that the glasses were good. I don't know what you all think. You can email me at journeyttc@aol.com and let me know. But they're kind of fogging up, Trey, so I think I'm going to take them off. So they're not prescription. I'm just trying to be cute, trying to be a little different. You know how that goes. I just want to also give a shout out to Andrea, who is our original co-host. She's been away for a little while. We thank God because she is doing well right now, recovering. And I know God's grace and his hand is upon her. Today, we have a wonderful topic for you. We're revisiting the topic of grace, which we've done here quite a few times on the journey. But even as Paul and Peter in the Bible talks about growing in grace and knowledge of God, it's okay to repeat that topic, because as we're going and growing in grace, there are more things that's being revealed that I want to share with you. And I want to be really, really, really transparent on this show. That's one of the things that this ministry was birthed through and birthed on, is transparency. I want to revisit what the journey to the cross and beyond is all about, what we stand for, what our mission is. And I always say it here a little bit in a nutshell when we start, our journey really is to understand the love of God, which includes his grace, and to walk in the revelation and the understanding of that love. Our journey to the cross is to really understand what that meant when Jesus went to the cross for us and died for our sins. What has that enabled us to do? And the beyond part was added. When we first joined the Matrix Studios family, we were just the journey to the cross. But beyond was added early last January 2013. We're in our third year now, third season of the journey. Praise God for that one. Still going strong because of his grace. The beyond is really to understand what happens once you've accepted Christ. What is the life that awaits you beyond the point of of salvation? And it definitely is a journey of transformation, just discovering God and discovering who you are in him. The journey was always intended to be just that, a journey where you see the host and our guests and everybody that comes along here, even our engineers, even Damien, who is the CEO of the Matrix Studios, to watch us grow as we move beyond the cross and really discover what this life is all about. And in being transparent, we want you all to see when we fall, when we come short, and to see how God's grace is able to restore us. Your fall may not always be due to sin, whether it be lying, stealing, cheating, fornication, adultery, whatever it is, but sometimes your fall is within you. It's your mindset. It's just things that you're struggling with. It's strongholds. So really the topic today is falling into God's grace. We often talk about falling from God's grace, And the Bible tells us that we all have fallen short of God's grace. But it also tells us that he's able to establish us. It's his grace and his love and his mercy that keeps us going. And I want to really explore that today. We have been running a series focusing on young people that has been living for Christ and taking a stand for Christ, but God kind of shifted it. And I just want to remind myself and our audience about the Journey's foundation scriptures, Romans chapter 8, verse 1 and 2, which tells us that there is no condemnation to those that are in Christ who walk according to the Spirit, where you're led by his Spirit. There is no more condemnation. That mindset that you're always feeling condemned, that is absent when you're in Christ. And also, Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17, 18, 19, not 20. 20 is the one that everybody knows that my God is able to do exceedingly and abundantly. But 17 and 18, if you look at it, it really speaks to me. It speaks to what the journey is about. And in there, Paul is talking about growing in the love of God, understanding how wide, how big, how deep, and how far it is for us. So I want to reestablish that, because I've come across quite a few people who, and I've been very honest here myself, that have struggled with just condemnation and trying to do this walk in their own strength, and it is impossible. So that's why I'm revisiting the grace of God and falling not from grace, but falling into the grace of God. I'm just going to be throwing scriptures out because that's what backs me up. Romans 8, 38, 39, somewhere around there, or both. It tells us that nothing is able to separate you or me from Christ. Nothing at all. Not death, not your sins if you give it over to him. Not life, not people, not principalities, not angels. Nothing is able to separate us from the love of God. And I just want to revisit that, because again, his love and his grace, they go hand in hand, and it's so big that you can't understand it. You know, that's going to take your whole life to just understand the revelation of the different levels of God's grace and God's love. I want to look at the definition, a really short definition of what grace is, and it's only God's grace that I can't even say this. Grace is love and mercy given to us by God, not for any other reason, but just because he desires to give it to us. That's it. Not because we've worked for it, not because we deserve it, because truth be told, a lot of us don't deserve anything but some punishment and a whole lot of slaps and all that other stuff. That's like me talking to my girls. I'm always like, you want slaps? But as I'm walking in God's grace, I'm learning to be gracious to them as well. You're going to see me keep looking in my book, because I was just going on and on and just writing and writing and writing. I just want to back up a little bit. And when we're talking about this Galatians, I'm going to look at it, because one of the things I always say I'm not going to do on this show is argue doctrine. Because every church I go to or visit that may have a little difference in the way they view things, I still feel the presence of God there. So to me, God clearly isn't wrapped up in you say tomato and I say tomato. It is his son, Jesus Christ, and his mercy and his glory that he is wrapped up in. So I want us to go to Galatians. I don't always have Bible open and all of this on the show, but it's just where I'm being led. Galatians chapter... Let's see. Hold on, y'all. Okay, Galatians chapter 5, verse 4. You who are trying to be justified by the law are alienated from Christ. You have fallen from grace. And a lot of people use that to say that we can fall from grace or lose our salvation. I'm not going to debate the whole thing about losing our salvation. I just read one little piece of the scripture. That's because I want you to go back and read actually the whole chapters in Galatians 1 through 6, to find out exactly what Paul is talking about when he talks about us being able to fall from grace. That is what I want to focus on today. A lot of people say, you know, if you sin, you've fallen from God's grace. However, what Paul was addressing a group of Christians in Galatians who had already accepted Christ, accepted liberty in Christ, and there were other believers, or so they say, that came in and started to tell them that they needed to do this. You needed to walk right. You needed to dress this way. You needed to be circumcised. You needed to follow all these practices. And what Paul was saying is that the grace of God already liberated us. And when he's talking about falling from grace, it's not falling out of God's hand and, you know, you're off on your own. He was saying that the liberty that you had in Christ, the understanding, the revelation, the freedom in God's love, you've chosen to put that aside to take on law and rules and regulations and works. Working again for salvation or working again for God's approval when God already approved us through his son, Christ Jesus. So I want to really encourage someone today that's really feeling condemned, because again, I'm coming across a lot of that, to let you know that whatever it is, whatever the issue is, whether it be in your mind, whether it be spiritual, whether it be an actual sin or whatever state you are in, the only way you're going to fall from God's grace is if you don't accept his grace. And we fall into condemnation, and I've struggled with this. I've told you all over and over and over again, when we don't receive God's grace for whatever our situation is, when we don't receive his forgiveness, when we don't receive him empowering us, his grace empowering us to live the way that he wants us to live. He said, "Be holy because I am holy." And for God, it's easy for him because he's God. But we all know that we have a sin nature in us. And there is no way on this earth that you're going to be able to walk this Christian walk by yourselves. That's where condemnation and pride comes in. I've been there. I know. Trying to do everything right, do everything perfect so that I could be pleasing to God. That's when I fell from grace, because I wasn't using his grace to empower me to do the things that God wants me to be. Or sometimes God doesn't want you to do anything but to receive what it is that he wants to do for you. So I want to encourage the viewers on today to let you know that God's love never fails. It never gives up on you. This is a lifelong journey. I'm not saying to abuse God's grace. I'm saying to use God's grace, not only to get up when you fall, but to empower you to live the life that he has called us to live. So I want you all and myself to fall, but fall into God's grace that empowers us to do all things. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. We're going to go into this video by Jesus Culture, "Your Love Never Fails." And just watch it. If your heart is stirred, just open your heart to him. If you were feeling condemned because whatever happened during this week, get before God. That's where his grace lies. If it's sin, then you need to repent. If it's your mindset, if it's worry, don't fall from God's grace. Fall into God's grace. He says in our weakness, whatever your weakness is, that his grace is sufficient enough for you. And it's sufficient enough for me. Jesus Culture, "Your Love Never Fails."
Yeah. never fails. His presence never fails. His mercy never fails. His kindness is never ending. Your grace is never ending. Your faithfulness is never ending. Your love is never ending. Oh, Father, your love is never ending. Oh, Father, your love is never ending. Just in your own words, begin to thank him for his presence, for his love. Your love is never end. Your kindness is never end. Your mercy is never end. Your love, your love. Your love, your love. That's right, just lift up your voice. Just tell him in your own words. Your love, your love. Your love is never end. Your faithfulness is never end. It's your love never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me. Your love never fails.
And we're back. I absolutely love that video, Europe Never Fails by Jesus Culture. We're just continuing on with our topic, which is falling into God's grace. I just said I wanted to revisit God's love and what the journey is all about, and journeying to walk in his love and walk in his grace fully every day, accepting his grace every day, his grace that empowers us, because we cannot do it on our own, to live the life he has called us to be. Please do not be mistaken. I am not here saying that you can do whatever it is you want to do and just keep on calling on the grace of God. God knows our hearts, and you know, if we're really walking in God's grace and a revelation of his love, we really do not want to do things that is contrary to our standing and our position in him. But we need to fully understand that as his heirs, as brothers and sisters of Christ Jesus, we have to bank on God's grace. When I was a new believer a couple years ago, not that long ago, I used to say, you know, I used to watch people and before they even did things, they would be like, oh, I'm going to do this and just ask God to forgive me. And that really, really troubled me because I wanted to make God's heart glad. And I'm sure a lot of you feel the same way. And I didn't know how to go about doing that. And I thought it was my works that would cause God to be happy with me or say that, you know, I'm worthy for whatever it is, worthy for him to love me, hug me. Meanwhile, in my sin, Jesus already died for me. And you know, even more so that I've accepted him, will his grace shine upon me. But when you're kind of stuck in your own pride and used to doing things your own way, that's, again, what I'm going to say. You fall from God's grace because you're not walking in it and you're not receiving it. And I used to say, you know, I hear all these people just loosely grace abusing, and I am not banking on God's grace. I actually said that because I didn't want my heart to get into a place where I just did whatever I wanted to do and then get before God and be like, oh, God, forgive me, when the state of it was I was already determined to do what I wanted to do. So I set out on this journey to do everything right in my own strength. I was going to dot every I and I was going to cross every T. And that causes you to be in a miserable state because it is impossible to do in your own strength. That's why Jesus went to the cross for us, because God knew that we couldn't redeem ourselves. God knew that in our fallen state, we would never be able to accomplish a walk of righteousness and holiness. That's why he's clothed us in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. That's why we need his grace. Now, since I've been on this journey a few years later, and I've fallen quite a few times, sometimes daily, it don't have to be what you do. It could be even in your thoughts. You know, it could even be in your desires. I know that I cannot live without the grace of God. I know that I cannot walk this walk the way he wants me to without his grace. The fact is, once you're saved, you're saved. But I do not want to just be saved. I want to grow. I want to grow into the knowledge of God, who he is, the beauty of who he is, and continue to be revealed to myself to know who I am. And I want the same for the viewers as well. And the only way we're going to accomplish that is by grace. Does God want us to do good acts? Does God want us to do good deeds? Absolutely. Absolutely, he does want us to do that. Even sometimes it's in our deeds that God is glorified. Like the word tells us, let men see your good works and glorify the Father. However, that is not what gives us our position in Christ. Maybe when you get to heaven, your deeds may give you some jewelry on your crown. But right here, you know, and a lot of our deeds are going to be burned up, whether they're good or bad, if we're not actually in the will of God for our lives. So we can't get through this walk without God's grace. And I will say, if we're going to fall, the best place to fall is to fall into the grace of God. The only way that you cannot recover is if we refuse to take God's grace. If we refuse to receive God's grace, his mercy, his forgiveness, is if we refuse to realize that really without him, without his power, without his love, we can't make it. And again, that's why Paul says, you know, he went to God three times with whatever his thorn in his flesh was, whether it was spiritual, emotional, who knows? I think they left it out for a reason. But God kept telling him, my grace is sufficient enough for you. I have found that in my weakest moments, when I feel like I am nothing, when I feel down, when I feel depressed, is when God has used me the greatest. Because it's like in those moments when I'm at his feet and I'm crying out to him and I'm crying out for his grace and I'm crying out for him to restore me, for me, a lot of times it's my mind. I'm like my biggest enemy. I don't know about you, but I am my biggest enemy. And I always have to get God to restore me. And when I'm battling with not feeling worthy of doing anything or just sometimes just not even feeling worthy of living, I'm just being honest, I'm being real, I'm being transparent, because I know I'm not the only one that has gone through this. Like, my heart is stirred for a reason. And it's in those moments where I literally feel God, the grace of God, just lifting me up. And because I empty myself in my weakness, moments and realize my weakness, it makes me look at him and his strength. And when I decrease, like John said, when I decrease, when I'm out of the way, when I cannot do anything in my own strength, when I cannot encourage someone in my own strength because I'm feeling weak because of whatever I'm going through, then God is really able to move. And when I do speak, it is him that speaks. When I do whatever it is he has me to do in the moment to lift somebody else up, it's not me. It is in him. And I know when the ladies of Your Girlfriend's TV and Triangle Trade was on last month, we talked about falling as well. And one of the things that they said is falling is important. If you check yourselves, those of us, you know, sometimes we get on those spiritual highs, you know, and God just used me to do this and that, and I'm here, and I'm, you know, I'm worshiping God every day, and me and God is good and tight, and I got like triple anointing right now. What happens right after that if you're not careful? Oftentimes after that, when you've been on that mountaintop, something happens, whether it's because you stepped out of your daily communion with God, because that's when I'm at my weakest, is when I'm not really going before him like I usually do. When I step out of my pattern, I'm going to call it a pattern because discipline is necessary, and I do struggle with that too. I'm being transparent, y'all. That's when you have those moments when you fall, where you act out of character or you do or say something that, you know, I've been delivered from that. Why am I back here? And it takes you from that mountaintops and brings you back down, not necessarily in the valley, but it reminds you who God is. It reminds you of his sovereignty, and it prevents you from feeling like you are so high, you are so mighty, and don't need God, and you got here by yourself. That's what it does for me. And that, when I say falling into God's grace, in those moments, in those weak moments, you fall right down into God's grace, because it's his grace that's going to elevate you and lift you back up. So again, I'm just encouraging a mindset on today. I'm encouraging a spiritual walk on today. I'm encouraging a person today to get up. Get up when you fall. Get up by falling into God's grace, his mercies, which endures forever, forever, forever. I want to just shift just a little bit. I want to tell you all something that I must confess. I must be like the Pope today. I'm really into confessing. And I'm confessing to you all today. So actually, you would be the Pope. But I thank God we don't have to go to anyone to confess. We could go right to Jesus Christ. I don't know how many of you have actually gone to see. We still on our topic. You know, if you watch The Journey, you got to keep up, because cable kind of go right, left, center, and then right, left, east, west again. So I'm bringing it back in. But I got to tell you about Noah, and I have to tell you about the movie God's Not Dead. And it kind of ties into the topic as well. I went to see Noah, took my daughters and another child with us. Really, the kids wanted to see God's Not Dead. But in my mind, I wanted to see that movie all by myself. And I thought, you know, they wouldn't understand some of the language and they would be bothering me. So I was like, no, we're going to see Noah because it has action and you'll more be able to relate to that. First mistake, always follow the child. The child shall lead you. So we go to see the movie, and my expectation, I did expect for them to, you know, add storylines to it, and I didn't expect it to be exactly the way the Bible is written. But I have to tell you, I'm not trying to discourage you from seeing the movie. I'm just telling you how I feel. Creative, artistic, absolutely it was. Russell Crowe did what it is that Russell Crowe does. He's a great actor. But I could not sit there and watch the entire movie of Noah. Neither could my kids or the other child that I was with. It disturbed me, the portrayal of God. I'm not going to say too much because I don't want to discourage you from watching it. The portrayal of what fallen angels or demons, how they really fell from heaven and what they came here to do. To me, God was made out to be more kind of the bad God, even trusting a crazy man, Noah, to do his work, to save those animals and the human race. And also, it just made him seem angry. It made him seem, to me, everything that he isn't, or that perpetuation of God not really being a loving God and always wants to punish and lash you and zap you. So because I came from a place where that was my revelation of God then, before I had my own encounter with him, it really troubled me, and I couldn't sit through it. And I can be a little mischievous. Forgive me, Lord. So through the movie, I'm like, read your Bibles, people. You know, trying to get low, and I'm getting louder. I'm like, read your Bibles, people. Now, these people have a right to pay their money and see their movie without somebody like me interrupting them. I was wrong. And when it got to the point where, okay, it looks like they're saying the demons helped Noah built the ark, I was like, my kids and I, we looked at each other and we said, okay, now it's time to exit. But before I exited, I said, I was so troubled. I was angry, actually, because I just didn't want people to leave there believing that this was God's character and that this is the person that he is. And I just wanted to stand up and tell the world, like Molly Music and Lecrae, I'ma tell the world, tell him everywhere I go. I was gonna stand up in the middle of the movie theater and the place was packed and people paid their money, and I was gonna tell them, that's not how God is. Go home and read your Bible, right? I would be sounding like the angry Christian. And I've said it on the show, like, I do not like to see us picketing in front of abortion clinics and things like that and holding up signs, because that doesn't represent who God was. But in this moment, I let my flesh get the best of me. And to be honest, Trey, the Holy Spirit said to me, talk about his grace. His grace is trying to save me from humiliating myself. He said to me, be still and know that I am God. And I will be exalted. And, you know, I did the little games where, okay, maybe that's just in my mind. That's not what he's saying. And I watched a little bit more, and I got angry. And we talked about flipping the channel on this show for this reason. When things start to get you riled up, you know you need to change the channel or leave, because that's not for you. Not to say that you didn't enjoy Noah. You can go watch it. But for me, in my household, it was too much, because coming from a place where I thought God was that angry God and I struggled with receiving his grace and his love, that ain't the type of movie that I need to watch, because I don't need to revisit that. And I didn't listen to the Holy Spirit. I got up with my kids and I left, and I said I was going to say it in my nicest, sweetest cave voice possible. I was going to tell them. It just so happened I had just read the story of Noah again that morning. See how God is? That was my scripture reading for the day. And I was going to tell them that they should go to Noah, read the actual account of the Bible, and tell them about John 3:16, how God so loved them. I'm going out, and I'm thinking, I'm in my nicest voice, and I'm like, read your Bibles, people! Genesis chapter 4, when it's actually Genesis chapter 7. And I said, God is not like that. God is love. So, of course, my kids ran and left me, and I walked out. And my kids told me that I sounded angry. Like, I sounded like the angry Christian that I always say I don't want to sound like. That's exactly what I sounded like. However, when I got up, there was a slew of people that got up behind me that said they couldn't handle it either. Now, my fault in this is where I was wrong. I was right for leaving the movie from my personal convictions. I'm not telling you anything. I'm not trying to tell you to do what I do. This is for me. This is for my walk. It was too much for me. You can watch it and say it was just artistic. And, you know, indeed it was. But for my psyche, my mental being, my spiritual walk, I didn't need to be there. And shame on me for not accurately researching the movie to really find out that it was an atheist that produced, directed the movie, wrote the movie. So shame on me. And shame on me again. How dare me stand up in the middle of a movie theater and protest in that way, when God already told me to be still? God already told me that no one can soil his character, because it's the same way that I thought God was this angry God and I had to be perfect for him to love and accept me. But when I began to walk on this journey with him and really discover who he is, I began to realize, or as he revealed it to me, that that's not his character at all. So it's the same way that I have to allow people to discover his character and allow people to watch the movie that they spend $12 to $20 on without me interrupting them. And the other thing that I learned in that was sometimes taking a stand means shut your mouth and do nothing. Move the way you're supposed to move without saying anything. Because had I got up and walked out with my kids and never said a word, the same people would have got up and left behind me. All I was supposed to do was get up and leave. That's the example that I was supposed to show. That was the grace that I was supposed to show. Because I'm sure that those people watching that movie was like, oh boy, there go another crazy Christian. And it really bothered me. It troubled me because, one, I didn't listen. But I thank God for his grace. I thank God for his mercy, because I did really beat up on myself for doing that, and especially for not listening to the prompting of the Holy Spirit. And what did I do? I fell right into God's arm, and I fell right into his grace. And I want to release that to you today about God's grace and about God's awesomeness. And it just kind of stirred me again to just talk about God's love and his grace. Because I have to say, at the end of the day, I was glad that I saw the movie, because it made me just go into worship. Because coming to the realization that that's how I used to see God, but he's allowed me to see him in this way. Honestly, now that I'm thinking about it, I needed to see where he brought me from and where I am in a relationship with him now, that I won't sit there and believe that this is how my God is. But through my own personal experience with him, I've come to know his love. I'm learning the depths of his love. That's going to be a lifelong walk for me. With that being said, because I think I've talked quite a lot, and I'm going to talk some more, we're going to get into this video, Your Grace Finds Me. Wherever you are, God's grace will find you. It found me in the movie theater after I made a mess of myself. Matt Redman, Your Grace Finds Me.
There in the newborn cry, there in the light of every sunrise, there in the shadows of this life, your great grace. It's there on the mountain top, there in the everyday, sorrow and the dancing, your great grace, oh such grace. From the creation to the cross, there from the cross into eternity, your grace finds me. Yes, your very
same for the saint and for the sinner. Enough for this whole wide world. Your great grace, oh such grace.
It's just you and I today. We riding dolo, solo. Well, I'm not really solo because Trey is here with me. Shout outs to Trey. Very nice looking young man. And he's doing a great job thus far. And of course, I'm not alone because not only is God with me, but you are as well. We are talking about falling into God's grace. We said we cannot do this walk, this Christian walk, without the grace of God. We have to realize that our pride or our own self-efforts is not going to get us anywhere. And I just wanted to share this. When we're judgmental, that's one way that we can fall from God's grace, because God expects us to show people the same kindness and mercy that he has shown to us. I mean, we can't match his level, but because he lives in us, he will empower us to do that. That's also what grace allows you to do. I find that when I fall, when I make mistakes, when I stumble, when I'm off my mindset or whatever it is, and I have to get before God, cling to him, cleave to him, depend on him, bank on his grace, check that never bounces, and we're not saying take advantage of it. I find that it makes me less judgmental towards others, but still not condoning whatever the sin is. I just gave like a little example about me being in a movie theater and literally getting up, trying to start a riot because I didn't like the movie and how wrong I was for doing that. Yet on the flip side, I get so disturbed when I see my fellow brothers and sisters, and they are, you know, picketing against this and that, and not in a way that Christ would want us to, or standing in front of abortion clinics and holding up signs telling the people that God hates them. You know, that is an error, and it's wrong. But because I was just in a situation where I did something very similar, it made me think about how easy it is to point fingers or to look down on others because of where they are. And I literally became a person that was holding up that picket sign that was saying, God hates you, in that moment. So it made me like not look at them so harshly or point fingers at my brothers and sisters in Christ that do that, but still not condoning what they did. It's still wrong, but it made me realize that even I have the capability of doing that if I'm not walking in God's grace and moving in his spirit, because his spirit was very present on that day and telling me to be still. But in that moment, I guess in that moment, you can say I fell from grace because I chose not to use the grace that he was giving me to give me wisdom to shut my mouth. With that being said, I just want to just read a couple notes that I took as I was just going crazy with this topic. Falling from grace doesn't mean falling from one's position as a child of God. I often say here on the show that our position is that we're in Christ, we are saved, we are righteous through him, we are holy through him, we are heirs with him, we are in the kingdom of God. However, our practice sometimes does not match up, or as we're on this journey, we're journeying for our practice to meet our position and our standing in God. It's whoever reverts to old ways, whether religious law keeping or hardening a non-repentant heart, those are the ones that have fallen from the experience of God's grace, refusing to take advantage of it, refusing to bank on God's grace daily. That's how you fall from God's grace. Our experience of God's grace is not secure, but our position in the grace of God is. Okay, you get that? Our experience of God's grace is not secure, but our position as children of God, as redeemed in the grace of God, is secure. What does that mean? I can forfeit God's grace, and I just said it, by choosing to try to do everything on my own, do everything in my own strength, refusing to receive his forgiveness, refusing to forgive others, being judgmental. That's really how we fall from God's grace. God's love will never fail. His arms are always open. And I want to stress this again. I'm not saying be a grace abuser. That is not what I'm saying. I am not saying conform. I am not saying do not grow in Christ. Do not get to the point where things you used to do yesterday, you no longer do them. What I'm saying is come to the realization that it is not you achieving these things on your own, but it's Christ working in you. It is the grace of God that really, really empowers us to walk this walk. And the sooner we realize that, the more free we will be. That's the liberty that we have in Christ, and knowing that, you know, I kind of have, like Paul said, the things I want to do, I don't do, and the things I should do, you know, that whole story, old wretched man that I am, realizing that there's still a part of us that is contrary to God and to his walk. And so we cannot trust ourselves. We cannot rely on ourselves, but we can rely on the grace of God and the Spirit of God that lives in us. I want to share a story with you, and just to kind of drive it home, how dangerous it is when we don't fall into the grace of God, but we choose to move away from his grace. There was a young man that, true story, guys, true story. He was a pretty bad guy, pretty bad dude, and he would beat up all the kids in school and bully everybody in the neighborhood, and everybody hated him, and everybody was scared of him. And one day, he actually went to church, and the Holy Spirit tugged on his heart, and he gave his life to God. And in that moment, he repented of everything that he had done, and he set out on this Christian journey. And he never fully understood the grace of God, because he really tried to be perfect. He really tried to dot every I and cross every T, but he tried to do it in his own strength. And it got to a point where it weighed on him so much. Every time he would mess up, every time he would fall, because if you try to do this in your own strength, you're going to keep falling over and over and over and over and over again. And that's what happened to him. And what he did was he even went into into the mountains, into a secluded area, because he just wanted to be so close to God. He wanted to get to this Zen state where he was just perfect. He was a perfect human being and never had a wrong thought. And, you know, he had to achieve it because he was still trying to work out the things that he had already done in the past. He never got over that. He never really gave that to God. He never really accepted grace when he came to the point of salvation, to know that that is all done, that is forgiven. You don't have to work for this. And he'd go off in the mountains for months at a time, not eating for days and months, just trying to get to this place where when he came back off the mountain, he would be perfect. And he'd be good for 2-3 months, never thought anything wrong, never did anything wrong, never said anything wrong. But then he'd fall again. Because in our strength, we are not able to. But in those weak moments, God's strength comes in and empowers us to do that. And unfortunately, he never got it. And it drove him crazy to the point where, sad to say, he committed suicide. He committed suicide because he just thought this walk was too hard and he couldn't do it. And he missed the greatest thing, which was that God's love would never fail him. God's love, if you allow God in, if you allow his grace to move in your life, he'll put you where he wants you. Philippians 1 verse 6 says that, and I often say this to myself when I find myself just fighting against my own flesh or fighting against my mind, fighting this battle. That battle is always raging because we still got a little bit of that old nature in us that we're carrying along. That is why the Bible says for that it has to die daily. Daily it has to die. But God's grace, by his grace and his mercies, which is sufficient, we're able to overcome that. It's a very, very dangerous place when we, as children of God, fail to walk in the grace of God, fail to fall into the loving grace of God that picks us up, that reminds us of his goodness and his sovereignty and empowers us to live. There's no other way to do it. So I'm going to tell you this, and I'm speaking to myself. I'm going to watch this when I'm done. Is stop walking in condemnation. Get up. Get before God. Be honest. Sometimes God is just waiting for you to be honest. Instead of trying to, you know, fix things up or look pretty on the outside, just be honest with God about where you are and work with him as he does the work in you. Now I know what I was trying to say. Philippians 1 verse 6. He that has begun a good work in you, he shall continue it right up to the day we see Jesus. I'm banking on that. Because for me, there is so much more growing that I need to do. There's still so much things that I struggle with. If I could be transparent again, I'm not going to get into details. But even upon this week, like, I really had to call on the grace of God because I was really tempted to do something that I've struggled with as a child that I know there's no convincing me otherwise that I've been delivered from. I talked about this before. If you ain't catch the show, well, you should have been watching. And, you know, it was funny because this temptation came up on me. And I wanted to do it so bad. Everything in me, my flesh was just taking over at the time. And it was like, you know, just do it. It was a couple times this week where I felt like doing this thing that I struggled with for so long. But God's grace did deliver me from it. Now here it is again, right? Not that I'm not delivered, because I declare today that I am. But it came up in my flesh, you know, to try to trick me, to make me feel like, no, you weren't delivered from that, but I say that I am, and I will continue to be. And it was very overpowering, and I had to call on the grace of God because I wanted to give in to my flesh. And God was the one that had to rescue me from the situation, because I literally felt powerless, and I needed him to step in and help me in that very moment. You know how he helped me? He knocked me out and made me go to sleep. And when I woke up, it was a wrap, you know? And yeah, it happened again later on in the week, and I really had to call upon that grace of God because I could not do it by myself, really needed his grace in the moment. And he did it. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, it tells us that there's no temptation that has not beset man, you know, and that with God will not put more on you than you're able to bear. And with the very same temptation, he will provide a way of escape for you. So when I was struggling with in my flesh this week, what saved me from giving in to those temptations was the grace of God in the form of knocking me out, put me right to bed. He is able to do all things. Let's get into another video. And then when we come back, I want to tell you what is going on in our spotlight on the community. What's next, Trey? What we got next over there? Oh, I know. Newsboys, your love never fails. I didn't tell you about God's Not Dead, but please, 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 please go and see that movie. It is excellent. It is awesome. I took the kids. I should have listened to them in the first place, and they absolutely loved it. The language was not too much for them. The Newsboys have a cameo in this movie, and also if you watch Duck Dynasty, they're in it as well. It's about a young college student whose professor is an atheist and wants him to basically write on a piece of paper saying that God's not dead. But God's grace convicted the young man, and he was not able to do that. So he had to challenge the professor to prove that God's not dead. And the whole theme, the plot is awesome, awesome, awesome. Please go and see God's Not Dead. Double thumbs up. Again, if you want to see Noah, that's on you. For me, wasn't the best thing for me. But I'm not going to put that on you. Your love never fails, the Newsboys.
Nothing can separate, even if I run away. Mistakes. You have new mercy for me every day. Cause your love never fails. Oh no, no, no. You stay the same through the ages. Your love never changes. There may be pain in the night, but joy comes in.
Yeah.
was stay the same through the ages. Come on, y'all. Your love never changes. I'm the night when joy comes in the morning. We're back. We are about to wrap up our topic, falling into God's grace. And that's what I want. I want to fall in it. I want to grow in it. I want to be strengthened by it. I want to be empowered to live as a child of God by it. I want to be empowered by his grace to do what it is that he's called me to do. I want to be empowered by his grace to receive whatever it is that he wants to do. That is the grace of God. I want to share just a couple more things before I talk to you about something. Galatians chapter 2, verse 17 through 21. Just a little commentary, or actually Galatians 1, verse 6 as well. I'm going to say this. The test of the gospel is grace. The gospel of Jesus Christ that says that God came to earth in flesh, the word of God, the son of God, however you want to see him. I'm not here to debate doctrine. And he died for us to redeem us of our sins. He died so that we can have a clean slate, that we could be brought back into communion with God. That is the reason why he came here. He also came here to show us how to walk in the grace of God and to show us how to live. He's an example to us. He experienced everything that we experienced, so he knows, and he can have sympathy, or I don't even know if that's the right word. He understands the things that we go through. As I went through some things earlier this year, just in my mindset, and I cried out to God for his grace, because I was like, God, I don't even understand what's going on. I was just dealing with a lot of things that I really didn't deal with fully. And I said to God, you know, I really need your help right now because I don't understand it. And he said to me, I understand every thought. I understand every emotion. I understand every feeling. And I'm able to bring compassion to every situation. I'm able to bring my grace to every situation. So that gospel, if God's grace is not evident, then the gospel is a lie. The gospel of Jesus Christ is a lie. And I believe, and the journey believes, that every word that comes out of the mouth of God is true. So again, I'm going to say the test of the gospel is grace. If the message excludes grace or mingles law with grace as means either of justification or sanctification, or denies the fact or guilt of sin, which alone gives grace its occasion and opportunity, it is another gospel. And the preacher of it is under the curse of God. So in everything we do, we must think of God's grace. We must show God's grace. You know, sometimes I go through Facebook messages and I see people, you know, expressing their feelings and their thoughts. And I'm trying to be careful as well. But sometimes we, in taking a stand, can sound so judgmental and, you know, like we're above everyone else. But I say we ought to be careful. I am not a condoner of wrong living. I don't believe in it. I don't believe that God saved me to continue in my old ways. However, as I'm understanding the grace of God, I say take a stand, because there is too many of us that believe that we can just live how we want to live and we don't receive God's grace to live right. But on the same token, the Bible tells us that when you see your brother or sister overtaken in a fault, that we should go to them, you know, and show them grace with the same measure you want, whatever you want to be done to you, you should do it to someone else. And so I just say, perhaps we should be mindful in the way we approach things, in the way we approach people, in the way we spread the message of the gospel, in the way we spread the message of God's grace, in the way we say that we're standing for Christ, and we must stand for Christ. We must live right. Grace has empowered us to do that. But on the other hand, we cannot judge people. Restore them. And the other hand, grace also corrects people. God, one of the biggest things that God's grace does, it chastens you. You may not like it, I may not like it, but I need it. daily. I need the grace of God manifested through the Spirit of God to chasten me. When you've fallen from grace is when you're no longer in tune to God's grace through the Holy Spirit that chastens you. That's when you're in trouble. And if we see our brothers and sisters in these positions, we need to take all effort to try to restore them. Let's continue to pray for each other. Let's continue to encourage each other. Let's not beat each other down. With that being said, I just want to encourage you all. If anything said here on today just makes you want to say, God, I'm a sinner, and I believe that Jesus Christ died on a cross for my sins, and I want to repent from my sins, and I want you to come into my heart, and I want to live through your grace and through your mercies every day. And I realize this is not something that I can do on my own. Right now, you can just, right where you are watching me or listening to me right here as we sitting in the Matrix Studios, just say, God, Jesus, come into my heart. I accept you as my Lord and Savior. And in that moment, you are saved, and you are in the grace of God, and you are under the grace of God, and you are my brother and sister in Christ, and I applaud you. I'm just gonna thank God because I just feel like that touched somebody, whether now or if you rewatch, you know, I pray that God's grace will do that. I wanna turn to our spotlight on the community. The journey is going to continue to do fundraisers for our ministry that we partner with, which is Operation Christmas Child, a subsidiary of Samaritan's Purse. And what we do is we give shoe boxes filled with little items like pens, pencils, little sticky notes, markers, crayons, toothbrush, toothpaste, a washcloth, a wash rag, and we pack the boxes and we send them to impoverished countries all over the world. But the key to it is our focus is not on the boxes. Our focus is on the souls of those young children. Because for every child that receives a box, Operation Christmas Child, they go to the towns or the cities or the countries. They train the pastors on the ground that the children come to those churches to receive a box. Some of them never received a gift before. We've heard the testimonies here on the journey. You know, people who I know one story, little boy, family with HIV, and there's three toothbrushes that they're using for 12 people. And for them to know that people all the way across the world are thinking about them, it really is an introduction to God and to God's love. We have to remember that we are God's hands and feet. But the thing is, when they receive a shoebox, they go through a 12-week learning session from a booklet. It's called The Greatest Journey, which teaches them about Jesus Christ. So the shoebox is a way for us to bless them, but it's also a way for us to get the gospel into those countries and into those homes and into those hearts that we may not otherwise reach. If you're not able to pack a shoebox, we're asking for prayers that the right box will go to the right child. There's been so many amazing stories. And for one child that receives a box, it's been proven that up to 9 other people get saved. Half the children accept Jesus Christ after receiving the shoebox and receiving the discipleship program that comes with receiving the shoebox. And they take that message to their families. And a lot of them, their families get saved. So look out for that. Look out for the events that we're doing. The journey, along with Uniquely Anointed Ministries, Tracy Messias, look out for our flyers coming. We'll be hosting a fundraising gospel hip hop extravaganza. We're about worshiping without limits. We're going to have gospel rap. We're going to have a spoken word. We're going to have artistic praise. We're going to have artists painting during the worship and praise. And again, we are going to just worship God. It's going to be right here at the rooftop of the Matrix Studios, 1838 AD Avenue. That's Saturday, March 24th at 6 p.m. We'll go until, I'm sorry, did I say March? Thank you for catching that. May 24th, rewind. Thank you, Trey. Trey, you on point today. You got to work with me again. May 24th, thank you. Saturday, May 24th, right here at the Matrix Studios. The Journey, alongside Uniquely Anointed Ministries, presents a gospel hip-hop fundraising extravaganza. Keep watching us. You'll hear more about that, and I'm sure that the Matrix Studios will post it as well. Let's take a look at Uniquely Anointed Ministries' fourth annual conference. Tracy Messias is the conference host. That's my girl. Shout outs to you. God is really moving in this young lady's life. The conference is entitled Suddenly. So you need to come out to find out what that Suddenly is all about. Evangelist Jacqueline Carr, you know, she has this hit single out right now. She will be ministering. Evangelist Shayna Joseph, who's also been on both The Journey and Hidden Treasures. Minister Morris Coleman will also be ministering. Please don't forget to check out his show along with Ayanna every Thursday, Hidden Treasures from 9 to 10. And also this powerhouse woman of God will be preaching the word, Pastor Joan E. Whitaker. That is going to be at 81 Croton Avenue, Austin, New York. That's my neck of the woods. And that's May 30th through May 31st. The Friday night service starts at 7:30. It's an empowerment concert. Believe me, you will be blessed. $15 admission. Saturday from 11 to 1 p.m., there's going to be a more intimate session that is going to be led by Shayna Joseph. If you don't know, she has a powerful, powerful testimony. And then 2 to 4, Minister Coleman. And 7 o'clock will be the empowerment service with the woman of God, Pastor Joan E. Whitaker. So make sure you check that one out. You can email me about it, or you can go on Uniquely Anointed Ministries website, and information will be there as well. I'm going to definitely be in the place. And don't forget, Saturday, May 24th, come hang out with us here at the Matrix Studios for our gospel hip-hop worship fundraising extravaganza. It's only going to be a $10 cover charge, but you will be blessed. All the proceeds from this function on May 24th will go towards our efforts for Operation Christmas Child. Also, TMAT, today's ministry accomplishing. Let me just say TMAT. When they come, they can tell you what their acronym exactly stands for. We want to help them to get more sleeping bags out to the homeless in New York City. It's a wonderful thing that they do every year. And also, we want to be a blessing to Uniquely Anointed Ministries, as well as AFCOM, Ambassadors for Christ Outreach Ministries. Come out, come out, come out to these events and be blessed. It truly was a pleasure. I got to do what I love to do, which is just talk, 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 and talk. Did I talk your ear off, Trey? It was all right? You sure? You ready to accept Jesus? Okay, we'll talk off air. You see what I just did? I'm a hot mess, y'all. Sometimes you got to put them on the spot, right? Sometimes you got to put them on the spot. But I really thank you for doing the show with us today. We have some really good shows coming up. We're here every second and fourth Sundays, 5 to 7. We have a lot of new faces that's going to be coming to The Journey. So make sure you tune in 2 weeks from now, and you don't want to miss what we have in store for the month of May. I don't know why I keep saying April. Everyone, just have a blessed week. We know that we're in the Easter season, and we thank God for that, because this is the week that he laid down his life for us and took it up again, so we can lay down our lives, our past, and take up our life in him. Be blessed. We love you. Peace. Let's play this last video. Don't forget, when you fall, keep getting up, just like this young lady did, and she still won the race.
Matrix Radio Vision Live with DWI, live from the BXNY.